Hey everyone, Patrick CK here with episode 8 of 3D printing with the Model Price Maker Select V2. It's been almost 2 years since I got my own V2, and I thought it was time to look back and review my stretch with this printer. For all you peeps that have been watching since the beginning, you'll know we've had our ups and downs, so I want to try and encapsulate the last almost 2 years of experiences into one video. Many apologies for the even later than usual release of this video. Unfortunately, a 3-week hospital stint and rough recovery period has put everything on the back burner, but the love of my family and friends have brought me back from the brink. Of course, I wouldn't be here without the help of you peeps out there in YouTube land, so I want to make sure to answer a few questions that have been asked about the printer itself and the printing process in general on several occasions. I'm hoping this recap will help you decide if you should or not get a V2 of your own. Of course, you'll get my opinion in the end. So let's start from the very beginning. Back in 1987, I was born in a small village in... just kidding. But seriously, my first impressions of the V2 fresh out of box was of pure awe and enjoyment that continued through the straightforward assembly process. Of course, the first issue arose when I turned it on for its inaugural run. A busted control screen, which, admittedly, I shouldn't have blamed the shipper because this thing was impeccably packaged, making the damage even more curious. Nevertheless, I was still able to perform our first print, a random pre-installed demo, which turned out to be a delightful armchair that was a wonder to me and everyone I showed, obviously still new to the 3D printing scene. Now, printing demos is great and all, but of course you get a 3D printer to make your own stuff. And since the V2 uses the G-code standard for its model data, there are any number of CAD and slicing programs available to use. For me though, I went with Trimble SketchUp, formerly Google SketchUp, mostly because I've been using this program for over a decade in different capacities, but also because it's easy to use and mostly free. But like many things, as technology keeps progressing, we lose stuff in a shuffle. As of early 2018, the free version of SketchUp has moved to be a solely web-based application. While this is great for getting this program to the masses, the web version does not support extensions, which means converting the SKB files that SketchUp generates into SDL files used in 3D slicing programs is not possible. While the 2017 desktop version is still available for download, at the link in the description, in time, this version will become more and more outdated. So as of early October, basically right before my appendix decided to explode, I've been learning to use Blender. Now Blender is a completely different animal to SketchUp. It's been used to render CG in many feature films and utilized in tons of other projects, not just film. It does need a significantly longer time to learn, but it's absolutely worth it. Especially if you plan on making complex models like characters or figurines. Of course, I've been playing around with the integrated physics simulator and learning the basics of creating photorealistic scenes, especially around architecture since that is my original love. Admittedly, I've been focused more on rendering scenes and creating animations than working on 3D models or making YouTube videos. I'm not very good at focusing on one thing at a time. But the fact that Blender supports exporting to STL out of the box is a very good sign. I will definitely discuss this transition more in the future. Did I mention Blender is completely free? There's no pro version or any limits on its functionality just because it's free. In the meantime, I will still be using Cura as our slicing program of choice. At first, while still learning the ins and outs of the printer, I printed some random models like the demo sofa, a branded doorstop, and a keycap. Then I found a benchmarking model called the Benchy, a cute little boat that is basically a stress test for 3D printers. Printing a Benchy can help reveal issues from bad layer adhesion to cooling problems to issues with resonant vibrations. That's when the first mod came up. Now, I knew going in that modding this printer was a big part of owning it. This may be something that is not at all appealing for some people. I'm sure many of you would prefer the V2 to do amazing prints out of the box, and nothing's wrong with that, but this printer won't, especially if you want fine detail, and that's why it's only $300. Needless to say, that was part of the appeal for me. As we'll see, there's plenty of improvements to have. The first of these improvements was to install the Z axis brace mod. This mod basically fixes the vertical cantry in place so that any vibrations or movement in the tower wouldn't adversely affect the printing process. Using our bench, we pretty much saw immediate benefits. And the best part of it is most of the parts for the mod we printed, and everything else costs less than 10 bucks from the local hardware store. Next up was a better cooling setup by replacing the sock shroud and fan with one that delivered the air in a more uniform way to the print. We saw another improvement in our benchy. Again, we printed the main piece and everything else was under 10 bucks to get. The last series of mods were my favorite and revolved around the filament spool and making sure the filament moved around the printer as smoothly as possible. This project was especially important because it was an almost completely with inspiration original design that turned out even better than I expected. Of course, I went into great depth and detail about each of these mods in their own videos. If you haven't seen them, check them out in my 3D printing playlist. So far, so good. I've had a blast making and installing these mods, printing random and useful models, but as with anything, there is a dark side. Some may even consider these mods a dark side, but I don't. Nonetheless, there were two issues that did hamper using this printer until they were fixed, and ones that I would call defects. One of these issues I did talk about in depth in episode 6. The short story is due to a design fault. The gear that feeds the filament into the printer moved out of place, which required taking the entire printer head apart and essentially gluing the gear set screw back in place. The other issue was with the print bed not heating up. Several times all I had to do was mess with the power data cable on the back of the control unit and it would start warming up right away. I assume there must be a loose connector or something inside the control unit. After the third time of this happening, off camera, I took the control unit apart and made sure all the cables were properly seated. As anticipated, I did find one of the connectors for the bed was loose. Luckily, it was an easy fix to tighten the fastener back down, and it hasn't given me any trouble since. If you think you have the same problem, just be careful to make sure the printer is unplugged, because you do have to remove the power supply unit completely to get to the control board where the wires feed into. And if you touch the wrong thing, you're not going to have a good day. If you peeps would like a more in-depth video on this fix, leave a comment below. Oh, and one of the fans is making an odd noise at startup, but it goes away after a minute or two. It will probably need replacing eventually. So that's my experience with the V2 so far. Mostly good and fun to work with, but with the occasional issue. Luckily, nothing that required a major out-of-pocket expense to fix, only my time. During the same period, I've been asked tons of questions about the printer and the printing process. I won't be able to get to all of them today, but keep them coming. I make an effort to answer as many as I can. No question is too daft. Just don't ask what my favorite color is, because it's green. First of these questions was, why did you take the spool holder off the top of the printer? I decided to move the spool holder from the top frame to the control unit, mostly because of the brace mod from episode 3. Watching how much it moved around while printing without the brace mod, I thought, why even risk it? A spool that weighs almost 10 pounds or 1 kilogram, brand new, is a significant weight even when compared with the printer itself. So why not move it from the top of the gantry to somewhere else? How accurate is the print time in Cura compared to real life? From my experience, it's a little optimistic in its estimates. Typically, it takes about 7% longer than estimates. So a 1 hour and 40 minute long estimate turns out to take closer to 2 hours. Not entirely sure why this is the case, since all the specs like feed speed and print speed are accurate. You bought the V2 because of the size of the print bed, but have you actually used the whole bed? So you're right, that was one of my justifications for buying this printer, as opposed to say the Monoprice Mini. And honestly, none of my models needed that much room so far. But it's a good idea to see if we actually got what was advertised. Of course, on closer inspection, and something that's completely obvious now, we can see that the printhead can't actually reach the edge of the bed. So it turns out that while the bed is physically 120 millimeters by 120 millimeters, the actual printable area is closer to 110 millimeters by 110 millimeters, making the advertised bed size a little misleading. How long does a spool of filament actually last? I get this question from peeps whether they are into 3D printing or not, and like many things, the answer is, it depends. But I did do some maths on a familiar print, our good old benchy. A benchy on normal quality uses 5.4 meters or 17.8 feet of filament, A standard 1.75 millimeter 1 kilogram spool will have roughly 400 meters or 1310 feet of filament. So if all we printed were benchies, we would be able to print 73 of them from one spool, something that would also take 6 straight days of printing to do. Would you still recommend buying this printer after using it this long? It has to be said, this is an entry-level printer that I think is great for learning the ins and outs of 3D printing. And for the price, you can't ask for more. In that respect, yes, I would still recommend this printer, with the caveat that modding it is a thing and part of the fun for me. And yes, you can print just fine without adding any mods, but don't expect show-level quality. It's also important to note this is not a commercial-grade printer, so if you plan on printing models on a consistent basis to sell or whatever, you'll be better off getting a more robust printer, but be ready to pay for it. As far as the Monoprice Mini is concerned, it does have less need for modding, but still not zero. It has a smaller print bed and slower print speed, making it hard to recommend right away, but it is usually $100 less than the V2. Unfortunately, those are all the questions I can get to right now. Again, if you have any more, don't hesitate to leave them below. I will do my best to answer all of them. I hope this follow-up on my experience with the V2 so far has helped to inform you all a little more on whether or not this printer is right for you. Well, this has been Patrick CK. Like and share if you enjoyed this content. Subscribe to get more videos when they come out, hopefully more often than not. Your support on Patreon and Amazon is very much appreciated. Hope to see you all next time. Thanks, everyone.